All right, and so we have Julia as well in the room. She's going to be presenting with me today, the webinar.
Hello, everyone.
Amazing. And we have Flavio as well that's going to help if there is like any questions in the chat. So while I share my screen and present, I won't see any questions, but there will be time afterwards to answer any questions and discuss a little bit, of course, if you want to. So I'm going to start sharing already. And Julia or Flavio, please let me know if anything doesn't work because I just won't see anything once I start sharing. All right. Can you all see the screen? Is it working? Julia, yeah? I hope so. Julia, is it working?
Oh, Laura is back.
Right. Sorry, guys. Internet in Costa Rica. We never know what happens. So I'm going to start sharing again and let me know, Julia, if everything is working well. All right. Is it good now?
Yes, everything's good.
All right. Sorry, guys, but we're back. Okay, so today I'm here to present you a really, really cool webinar. It's one of the projects that we've been most excited about in these last few years. So we've been starting working in Cocos Island in 2021, along with the SINAC or the government. And so this is a beautiful picture of Cocos Island. It's a paradise of the Pacific coast of Costa Rica, paradise for sharks and many other beautiful animals. And so we've been working a lot, especially on the coral reef, doing the crystal floor project, which is a beautiful name. And it's basically the study of the reef, but we're gonna go into details on why is it called the crystal floor. So I just wanna share that this is also a project that has been supported by the SOA for some equipment. So we're very, very grateful as well for their support. All right, so very, very fast. I know already a lot of you know about Innoceana, but I just want to share very fast who we are for those who don't. So Innoceana is an NGO of marine conservation, Innoceana for innovation in the ocean. So we're engineers, biologists, and professional divers. And our goal, of course, is to save the ocean, protect the ocean. That's, of course, why we work so hard every day. We started in 2017 in Spain with Carlos, who's the founder, and 2020 in the United States, where we're also a 501c3 in California, and in 2021 in Costa Rica. Though we've been working here for 4.5 years, almost 5 years now, but officially, legally an association since 2021. And yeah, a bunch of core values, innovation, education, engineering, conservation, international cooperation, and collaboration. Okay, so about today, it's going to be a more or less like 1 hour webinar, hopefully. We're going to go very fast into why do we work on hard corals, like why is it so important. It's going to be again a very fast section, and then we're going to spend more time on the concept of the project, like what is the crystal floor and what do we do, why do we do it. And then we're going to go into the results of the research that we've done in Cocos Island. And then we're gonna see what's next and what's the projection. And we're gonna also have Julia talking about the education project we've been doing there. Okay, so why hard corals? Well, I mean, for sure, all of you know that hard corals are super, super important. I say hard corals because there's also soft corals, but here we're gonna focus on the hard corals. And those are the ones that make the reef, right? And they cover only 0.2% of the planet, but they support more than 25% of marine species. So you can see here all little red dots, that's where we have coral reefs. It's so little compared to the huge, immense role they have in the ocean. So that's why it's very important to, of course, protect them and study them. So why they're so important, there's a lot of different reasons, but so they build this reef. So it's like a hard skeleton of reef that actually protects the coast from erosion, from hurricanes and storms and a lot of different events like this. So they're super important to protect the coast. Otherwise, we would just lose all our coasts. They're also, of course, shelter and habitat for many species, so very important for biodiversity, nurseries and source of food with all the little fishes, all the invertebrates, source of medicine. There's a lot of medicine that's been found in the corals as well. And of course, big economic value. We all love to dive and snorkel in the beautiful, brilliant coral reef. But they also have a lot of diseases. So for example, we have bleaching. Bleaching is very common. It's when they lose their color because they release the algae that is inside and when they're stressed. And so that's a big trouble because then they can't do photosynthesis and they will die, will start dying. They also have stress that is like this bright pink reaction that you see on one of the picture. On this picture, this is a stress reaction. It's the immune system responding. Also, of course, they are affected by viruses and bacteria. Anyway, there's like plenty of threats. Of course, the bleaching is directly linked to the climate change and the human actions and all of that. So plenty of threats, super important right now to protect them and to make a difference to try and save them, because otherwise the world will be very, very different without the coral reef. All right, so that was for a very fast introduction. Now I really want to spend more time into the concept. So the crystal floor, why do we call it the crystal floor? So the idea is that the ocean is like a crystal water, right? We can see, especially here in Costa Rica, we're very lucky, we can see through the water and we can see actually the corals. And so do you know those crystal balls, right? Those crystal balls are like, you can see the future through it. So the idea is that we can see our future through the crystal floor. And that's why it's called like this, because if the corals are dying, we can see it through the crystal water and we can see that the coral reefs are slowly dying. And that tells us our future. That tells us it's not looking really good for us or for the planet in general. So that's why we say the crystal floor, because we look through the crystal water, through the future of the coral and our planet. That's the idea of the name. So that's a good representation, for example. So when we take like pictures with the drone and we can see all the reef from the surface, that's a really good idea of what is the crystal floor. And as Sylvia Earle said, ice ages have come and gone and the coral reefs have persisted for millions and millions of years. We've gone through so many different ages and eras, and we've lost so many species and extinction and so many things that has happened, but the coral reefs have always been there and they've always survived. But now they're not surviving. And that tells a lot on the impact we have, right? So it's a really urgent matter. Okay, so what do we do? So the idea, of course, is to study the coral and to see how they are and to see especially the evolution through time and to understand really the best way to protect them. So the classic methods to do that is to put a transect line and to take all the data, right? To take all the data on the slate and write down all the data. It's a really good method, of course. It takes a lot of time though. And of course, it also depends on the scientist that's taking the data, because we all have our own way of interpreting what we see, right? But then you have innovation, and that's what we're trying to do, right? With innovative methods, that is here with through cameras and pictures, we want to do the same monitoring, but with more details. So that we use photogrammetry. Photogrammetry is this: we take a lot of pictures around a reef, and then we put all those pictures on the computer in a software called Agisoft MetaShape. And this software is going to do like a puzzle, and it's going to put all those pictures together and create a 3D model, right? So for example, this is a big 3D model. It's 100 square meters, so 10 meters per 10 meters. It's an underwater 3D map, literally. Here it looks like 2D because it's in 2D, right? But you'll see a video later and you can see it's really in 3D. You can like move it around, you can zoom in, zoom out. There's like so much details. So it's really, really, really visual, right? So for example, here you see, this is the 3D model, and that this you see that all the pictures that are aligned, that you can see more or less like this bunch of blue thing in here, So there's like about 400 pictures to make 100 square meter. So we took all the pictures manually, and then we put all the pictures together in just like about 20 minutes. We can do 100 square meter while diving, right? Those models are georeferenced, they're calibrated, they're super visual. Again, it can be used also for education. Well, I'm going in that just afterwards. But yeah, so we can put them on a map on Google Earth because we know exactly the GPS points, of course, where it is. And okay, so why is this interesting? Of course, super cool. It's like a 3D model, it's like innovative and all of that, but it has more goals, of course. The first is the baseline. So the baseline for monitoring. So with this 3D model, we can take a lot of data out of it. So we can calculate the percentage of coverage of algae, of dead coral. We can just see, we can see everything. It's like we are underwater, but we have taken the reef outside of the water, right? So we can do, we can take all the scientific data that we want out of this model. Of course, it's amazing also for education, because thanks to those models, we can actually show the kids and show the people what's a coral, and like in a lot more interactive way, rather than showing just a picture of a coral that looks like a rock. People can like understand a little bit more how important they are with this innovative tool. Of course, super important for awareness and how to fight climate change. And then there's like this other part that is, we create a model, right? So we create a model of what's existing right now on the reef, which thankfully in Cocos Island, we have a very healthy reef. But why not being able to use those 3D models in the future when, I don't know, maybe there is a big event, big rise in temperatures, and we lose 40, 50% of the reef from one day to another? It's very possible. It has happened in many places around the world. So we could have those models, and we could just recreate, 3D print those reefs with the models that we've created. So that's like more futuristic approach, but it's still very, very probable. And so I'm going to spend a little more time here on the baseline for monitoring, which is what we've been spending more energy on. And so there's two things we can do with those models that we've been working on, and that's the results that I'm going to show you today. So we've been calculating the substrate coverage. So you see here, this is my 100 square meter of 3D map. And with this, I can calculate the percentage of dead coral, of alive coral, of bleached coral, of algae coverage, of diseases, and I can see the evolution through time, right? So you see, I'm going to like go in and annotate all the little pieces, but I have so much time because I'm on the computer, I'm outside of the water, so I can do that a lot more precisely. I can zoom in, zoom out, I can decide, no, and maybe ask my colleague, do you think that's a disease? Do you think that's what type of algae? And so it's like a lot more precise, and we have a lot more details, right? And then we can just take out percentage of coverage, which I'm going to show you right now. And we can also calculate the rugosity. Rugosity, I don't know if you know that concept. It's a very, very important concept for the study of the health of the reef. It calculates the surface roughness, right? And so that means basically the bigger the rugosity, the best and the more healthy is the reef, because that means that we have a lot of relief in the reef. So it goes like up and down and up and down. There's like a lot of holes and all of this. And that means that there's a lot of spaces for little fishes, invertebrates to hide. And that just makes it a more healthy and rich reef. So we also call it reef complexity. And so how do we calculate this? It's actually the difference between the surface distance that you can see here. It's like if we were gonna put a line all around the corals, and that gives us a really big distance, and we divide it by the linear distance. That is just us going like over without going into the holes. And that gives us the reef complexity or rugosity or surface roughness, right? And we do this with a really nice program that you can see here, a screenshot that gives us the 3D model that we made here. And it's a very, very amazing program that just, you draw a line and it gives you directly the rugosity. It's a lot better because what we do right now to calculate rugosity in a reef, I don't know if you've seen that ever, but we put actually a heavy chain. It's like a big chain that we put on the reef, and it like goes on top of the polyps. So it's like very heavy so that it can go in all the holes. And so it's very invasive. It breaks the polyps, and it's really not the best, in our opinion, to calculate the rugosity, because it's a very invasive way. With that, at least we can just take pictures and we can calculate everything on the computer. Okay, so hopefully I can see all the questions afterwards and answer. I'm sure there's going to be some questions. So Cocos Island, let's go into the results. So Cocos Island is a national park since 1978. So it's a beautiful, beautiful national park. It's a World Heritage Site by UNESCO as well. It's a paradise for shark, huge paradise for shark. And it has the biggest coral reef in the Pacific of Costa Rica. Very, very, very healthy reef. This is a beautiful picture of one of the waterfalls in Cocos Island. And so what we did two expeditions in Cocos, one in 2021 and one in 2022. For now, and the idea is to be able to go back every year, hopefully twice a year, but sometimes only once a year whenever we are available and the park is also available. So we've done a total of 42 hours of underwater mapping, all diving and all with our cameras. We have our heads turning all around after that. We took 4,800 square meters of 3D underwater maps. That's a lot. And that means more than a million underwater pictures, just so many pictures, a lot of pictures. And that's a beautiful, of course, beautiful hammerhead shark that we always have around us whenever we do models and we take pictures and we work underwater in there. We just have the sharks coming around and it's super cool. Okay, so the first study we did, the first work we did, it's the RIL study of the reef. So we've been flying the drone, taking pictures and making like 2D models, but with the drone, of the reef. So you can really see here, it's literally the crystal floor. I mean, like you can understand the title very well here. And you can see that you can really see the reef by transparency of the water, right? So all of those are rocks, but for example, here, all the like black part is coral reef. And so with this, we can calculate the total coverage of coral. And we can see through the years if it's increasing or decreasing. And we can just see the evolution of the total coverage of the reef without having details on the species and then the disease and all of that, but just if the coverage is increasing or decreasing, right? Which is really important. And then that's where I'm going to spend a little more time. This is the governmental protocol. So in Cocos Island, it's really awesome because they have an amazing protocol for monitoring the reef that they have been doing for the past 5 years. So you see here in the first picture, they put down a transect line and they take data. So that's all the rangers of the island. And they take data themselves on the substrate, on the invertebrates, on the fishes, and they take data twice a year for the past 5 years or 6 years. So it's really amazing. So what we've been trying to do is adding to this protocol, to this governmental protocol. So along with the rangers and along with the government, to really try to just bring more details and bring more and more data to the monitoring that they're already doing. And so basically while they do the, well, I think it's just here. Yeah, exactly. So they put the transect line, it's like 40 meters and they start taking all the data. And on the same transect line, we're just gonna take a 10 by 10 meters square of pictures. And so it's gonna be in the same spot every 6 months or every year. And we're gonna have this, we're gonna be really able to compare the 3D models between the months. Okay, so first substrate coverage. What are the results that we got? So I'm going to present you the results, especially for 2021 and 2022. I'm not going to show you all of it, but I really want to show you like what we get out of it. So here, for example, it's a coral reef, very, very clear coral reef. I mean, it's like so much corals. And you can see here we have almost 90% of massive healthy coral. We have a little bit of algae, very, very little rock, a little bit of sand, very little stressed coral, and a little bit of sea urchins. But so you can see that it's super, super healthy. That's the perfect example of a very, very healthy coral reef. And here with all those annotations, we have exactly all the data and the percentage of coverage. We have another example here of another coral reef that is also quite healthy, but you can see here that like a lot more algae. It's already around 20% of algae and some unidentified as well. CCA is like a crustose, calcaline algae, and Cotylopora is like the branching coral that which we have a lot less. Rhodolite, rock, stress coral, urchin. So you can see we can really have all those results in details. This is a really cool one too. So this is in the shipwreck. There is like a wreck in the island where we always do the monitoring as well. And so you can see in here, we have all those pieces of old boats that are spread around. And so we can also have that that amount in details of like how much percent of the wreck we have in there and the healthy coral that's just been growing on top of it and also a bunch of algae and all of that. So again, a very, very healthy reef. And then we also do rocky reef. So that's a very, very different type of reef. This is more where we have like current and all of that. And so in there, you can see it's a bunch of huge rocks with a little bit of coral. So here we have a little bit of Potylopora and massive healthy coral, but the rocks are mainly covered in CCA, which is the crustose calcareous algae. So it's an algae that is made of like hard calcium carbonate base, and it just covers all the rocks. So it's also very healthy, right? But it's just a different type of reef and a different type of ecosystem, which is also very important to keep monitoring, no? And another example of, I think that's my last example because we have a lot of different data, but I'm not gonna spend 2 hours in this. Another rocky reef as well. So you can see, again, a bunch of CCA, a bunch of algae, but still a little bit of corals, which is interesting in those areas where there's like a lot of current and it's just very different ecosystem. Okay, and again, the most important here is that we wanna see the difference within the years. Now we don't have much data because we just have been twice, right? So the idea is to be able to keep going and to just with the years be able to really compare, and maybe in 4 years, 5 years, we can see a huge difference and we can really understand better the dynamic of the reef. And then we've been studying the rugosity. So this is with this program called Gridion, really, really nice program. And we've got a lot of different data of rugosity as well. So again, I'm not going to enter in details, but usually like more the rocky reef or have a little less, and then an increase. And that means those reefs are usually like the most healthy, if I can say, or the most complex, so that where you can have a more biodiversity living inside the reef. And this is really interesting. So you can see the thing is that is great with this 3D models, again, is that it's very visual and you can really like compare and see the difference and see visually, okay, we have a data of like a low rugosity here. We can see, well, it makes sense because here, if you see, it's like very flat, right? This is very, very flat in the bottom of the quadrants. And then here we have a little bit more rocks, but it's like there's not much really, not many corals and holes to get into. And then you can see, of course, until here where we have a lot of big rocks, and then it gets really high rugosity. Okay. And then lastly, I just wanted to talk very fast about that. So as I was saying, there is a shipwreck in Cocos Island, and we've already also been able to do 3D models of the shipwreck, which is amazing. So that it means this technique can really be used for anything you want to put in 3D, you can do, right? Until even archaeological sites and be underwater or outside the water as well, of course. So it's really useful as well to see all those corals growing around this boat, the shipwreck, and to see the evolution through time. Okay, I'm gonna pass the word to Julia so she can present the education project, and then we'll have a really cool video for you to show you a little bit the work on the islands, and so that you can see with more visual the project.
Thank you, Laura. Hi, everyone. So this is Julia. I'm head of education in Innoceana, and last year, 2022,
I went with Laura to Cocos to perform this amazing project that she was just talking about, the crystal floor. And it was the experience of a life. It was amazing, but I went there also for another reason, because I went there to write a book over there in Cocos Island. I wrote a book, it's an Inno Tales, and I'm gonna explain you a little bit about Inno Tales, what's the project about, and then I'm gonna talk about what were we doing there. Obviously, we did all of these along with the rangers of Cocos Island, and it was amazing. So I'm gonna talk about Inno Tales first. Inno Tales, it's an education project that was born in 2020, and it was born because obviously we all know there is a huge problem in the ocean. The ocean is in danger. There's so many threats. There's the climate change, plastic pollution, fishing industry, contamination, everything. The problem is that everything is happening underwater, so not that many people can see it, so it's not that much protected. So we try to find a solution. We are all the time trying to find solutions for this problem, but we really believe one really, really good solution would be education. Next. Thank you, Laura. Education is key. We believe children are the future, and that's why we came up with this idea of Inno Tales as a solution to bridge this problem between what is happening underwater and to show society, not only society, but to teach the kids in marine conservation. Basically, what is Inno Tales? Well, it's innovative tales about the ocean. These books are digital and interactive, and they're all about marine life. And they're mostly intended for kids, but I'm telling you also, adults can really, really, really learn and have fun with them. Basically, these digital books are full with audios, photos, and videos that all the Innoceana team has taken underwater, on Innoceana team and collaborators, of course. And it basically brings the reader to an underwater journey. You really, really are underwater with the characters and having fun and learning things. And the thing is that tales and basically books and storytelling have a high awareness potential, especially in kids, because they can like relate to these characters, and they learn a lot by just simply living what the characters are living. So some of the benefits. Let me change. Thank you. Some of the benefits of these books is basically that it teaches about the ocean ecosystem, about the biodiversity, about everything, but not only teaches about the good things, but also teaches about all the bad things, all the multiple threats that the marine life is exposed. But because we don't want to traumatize anyone, and we really are hopeful about the health of this marine life, we want to always show a hopeful and positive approach and show even possible solutions to these trends. And it's really amazing because it really lets the children enjoy the underwater world from the comfort of the house or even in the classroom. And it's really easy to use. Basically, you just need a laptop, a phone, or a tablet. And the idea is also with this project, we is helping also all the funds that go to this project also help Innoceana, which is, as you know, a nonprofit, and we are all the time fighting for ocean conservation. Okay, I want to talk next very, very fast about our first Inno Tales, which was A Turtle Named Raquel. This was released during the pandemic in 2020, and we had a huge, massive, massive impact. We especially had so many views, so many visits telling this story to schools, to other children, to communities. So many educators and teachers are using right now this book. And this was the book about a turtle that was born in Costa Rica and was traveling across the Atlantic Ocean and to the Canary Islands and looking for the seagrass. Next. And it was very amazing because it was not only had a lot of views, but it had views everywhere in the world. Here you can see a map that the same app which we use to do these books could tell us, and like everywhere in all America and all Europe and even in Thailand, where people over there reading this amazing book. So that made us very, very happy. And after that, we've done more books. We've done a total of 3 more books. They are all based in Spain, in the Canary Islands, because as you may know, also Innoceana has projects in Spain, in the Canary Islands, mostly about the seagrass. So most of these books were centered there. But finally, and this is the next slide, finally, and coming very, very soon, is coming the first InnoTale, the first book based in Costa Rica. And I am so excited about that. So this next book is going to be called Golfillo, the Hammerhead Shark. And it's a collaboration that we are going to do, what we are doing along the CINAC, especially with the rangers of Cocos Island National Park. And it's going to be about a hammerhead this time. And I can tell you in the next slide a little bit about the story. So basically, this hammerhead shark that is called Golfillo, it's named like that because it's born in Golfo Dulce, which is in the southern part of Costa Rica, right next to Corcovado. And he will travel across the ocean, passing through Caño Island, which is this beautiful first island, until Cocos Island. And all Golfillo is looking for is to find the hidden treasures in Cocos Island. I'm not gonna spoil anything about the end, but he definitely can find the treasure at the end. and very fast, I wanna talk about the process to making one of these books, and especially the process to make this book was very, very interesting. I was in Cocos Island at the moment that I was writing it. Here we have a picture of very happy girls, probably after diving, doing some research diving, and I was reading a lot. Not only this amazing book that is called Costa Rica Blue, but so many articles and so many things I was reading, not only about hammerheads and their skills and their abilities, but also about all marine life, because these books are very facts-based. And I never want to add anything in the book that is not correct. So I was reading a lot and collecting information. Then, because it's interactive, which means not only has videos and audios, but also the story is a choose your own story kind of story. So basically you can choose who do you want or where do you want the hammerhead, Golfillo, the hammerhead to talk to or to go. So it has an interactive storyline. It's a little bit tricky to put in places, but it's very important to put it before writing. And then it was right, day and night. It was a lot of writing because we were diving in the early morning and then it was writing during the night, but it was really, really fun. And then it was the moment to translate to English, because obviously I'm Spanish, I write directly in Spanish. And then it's the moment to record the audios. Every character that is present in the book has a voice, and all the videos are voiced over. So this time in Cocos Island, we had all the rangers from the Cocos Island station to put a voice in the Spanish version of Golfillo the Hammerhead. And actually here we have a present, Golfin, who is our main protagonist. He's one of the main rangers in Cocos Island, and he is the voice of the protagonist. So after recording all the audios, both in English and in Spanish, it's moment to edit all the audios together, and very, very important, collect all underwater videos. Obviously, we use videos from all our colleagues in Oceana. I am not the best videographer myself, but we have pretty good and very skilled people. So this is a crazy moment where we start collecting all the perfect videos and editing the videos together with the audios. Last step is design the digital interactive book. Basically, it's a very, very, very long process. And I would like to go to the next slide, but this is the real process. It's thousands of hours in the computer, going a little crazy and also challenging that with all the rest of the work that we have. So Right now, we are in the moment that I'm still collecting videos and editing audio. So we are very, very coming to an end soon. I think probably around June, but we will definitely publish the release date of the book that we are so looking forward to show you, because it's going to be a very, very exciting book. I'm sure both children and adults are going to love it. So to end this presentation, I just wanted to explain you a little bit what's next, both in the Crystal Floor project and the InnoTales project. So we want to come back. Of course, we will try to go back to Cocos Island at least once or twice a year to join in with the governmental protocol. We hope that we can come back soon. And next time we go, we will try to apply new technology, more technology. We would like to include ROVs, which are underwater drones, for more efficiency, because all the process and all the techniques that Laura was telling you about, obviously this is always attached to, you know, we are humans and sometimes it's difficult and the conditions are ruthless sometimes in Cocos Island. So maybe with an ROV would be a little bit more efficient, but still we definitely want to still go back to the water. The Innodales, Golfillo, the Hammerhead Sharks will be coming very, very soon. As I told you, we will release the launch date very soon, and I think it's going to be around June, July. So keep your eyes peeled for our next launching. And also next time we go to Cocos Island, we would like to introduce our IMOLO project. Our IMOLO project is Invertebrates Monitoring and Location. It's a project that we study all the invertebrates. We make pictures of them and we make an inventory about them. So basically we'll be doing a collaborative inventory along with the park rangers, along with other divers, of all the marine invertebrates that are in the island. Okay, and maybe now Laura would like to show us that beautiful video to summarize all these beautiful projects that we've been doing in Cocos. Of course, if you have any questions, we can answer them at the end of the talk.
Amazing. Thank you, Julia. So I'm going to show you this video. It's just 2 minutes, very, very fast, a little fun video for you to have more visual on the project. And then we'll be answering questions. Enjoy, guys. Hopefully the sound is in there as well. Becomes the fire. Amazing. All right. I hope you were all able to see it. I don't know if there is any questions that you can put, of course, in the chat, and we can answer them. And otherwise, for you to know, we will post this recording on YouTube so that everyone can just watch it whenever they have time, whenever they want, because we had a lot of demands for that. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you, everybody, for coming by our webinar. I hope you liked it.
Amazing. Hi, team. So nice. Are you also exploring doing coral propagation programs or any initiatives? So in Cocos, no, because it is not at all a necessary thing to do at the moment, because again, it's very, very healthy reef. Though we are doing coral restoration on the coast, so we are working with another two organizations here in the National Park Mayuayena on coral restoration, and also soon starting another project that you'll hear about for sure in the South Pacific of Costa Rica. But again, in Cocos Island is very, very healthy reef. So now it's just about monitoring. Amazing. For the crystal flow project, when you do the assessment of the images, is this done by eye or is there software that does this analysis? Very good question. So for now, we use the program called Beagle. It's a program that allows us to annotate all the model, the 3D picture. For now, it is done by eye. But this Beagle program, which is actually a free software, an amazing free software that is online, there is an artificial intelligence option. Of course, we need to train it. So for now, it's done by eye. Again, like cross-matching between different colleagues and scientists here. And hopefully at some point, so we can really like train the artificial intelligence software so that it can be automatic. I'm not sure how this will work, but that's our idea. Here with a few high school students from Collingwood, Ontario. They all say hi, amazing, thank you guys. This is so nice. I was wondering how you choose the spots to map and why those spots, but I don't know if I missed this in the beginning of the presentation. Hey, bye. So we are actually using the same spots that the rangers use. So those diving spots is the same that they go every 6 months to do the transect line. So there's seven spots, there's five spots for coral reefs and five spots now for rocky reefs. So it's a total of 10 diving spots. And we always do two lines in each spot. So one in the deep and one in the shallow. How they chose those spots, really, I'm not really sure. But I know that every site has their own particularity. So it's always an ecosystem that is quite different and almost all around the island. So I imagine that was more for like the diversity of the reef. What's your dream? What would you most like to achieve? Great job so far. Thank you. So our dream, wow, that's a big question. I love it.
To save the ocean.
To save the ocean. Yeah, that would be awesome for sure. So now we've been creating a marine conservation and education center in the south of Costa Rica. If you haven't visited us, please come and visit us. We are in around Ubitao Rochal. And so our dream is to be able to keep going and make those centers grow and hopefully be able to open a similar center in other parts of the world, because this is where in this center we want it to be like a hub for conservation, for research, for education, where we have all those projects and all those incredible scientists and people working together along with the community, along with the government, and along with the kids to really protect the ocean. So hopefully we can create more of those around the world as well and grow. How can you get involved? Well, again, a very, very good question. Thank you for asking that. So you can join us on expeditions. We have an expedition actually starting next week, and we have another two in March, and we have a bunch planned for the year. In expeditions, we actually do our own 3D models, and we'll work on a different research project. It's like a 7-day intense training in marine conservation, and on the research project we do. So we're going to learn about photogrammetry and about the transect line and the monitoring and the water quality and a bunch of other different things. So you can join an expedition and otherwise visit us here or just share our work, participate in fundraising events that we do. There's a bunch of ways to participate and to help us on the coast. Thank you so much for asking. Would you ever think of opening a location in Florida? It's not on our plan at the moment. We have the organization in California, though we don't have anything there yet. We don't have projects, or we don't have even an office yet. We just have the 501c3 status. So our first goal is to go to California and really start projects there and have an office and hopefully be able to build also a conservation center there. That will be our first step. And then maybe Florida later, but I don't know that for now. I think that's for you, Julia.
Uh-huh, Josie, what has been the most rewarding part about the InnoTales project and educating children about ocean conservation in general? Thanks for the question, Josie. I love it. Definitely the most rewarding part is to tell this book to the children and see their little faces, see how it impacts them, see how they learn, how they start changing their habits, even how they try to change the habits of their parents. It's really rewarding. And I've already been seeing a lot of little marine biologists in progress during all the workshops and talks and times that I've told these books and everything else. So I really love that. It's like seeing a bright future in them. Thank you.
Amazing. Thank you so much, guys, for your questions. I think that this is all. So I'll see you all very soon. And I wish you a beautiful day. Thank you so much for joining. And please
thank you.
The word. And join us in any way, whenever you want. It will be awesome.
Thank you so much, guys. Have a beautiful day.
See you. Ciao.